Because you see, there's a lot of groups that's saying, well, it don't take all of that. It don't take this, and it don't take that, that speaking in tongues. It don't take dancing, that Bishop Henderson. It don't take hallelujah and praise the Lord and amen. But you see, God never meant for us to intellectualize the spirit. Oh, y'all quiet up in here. The spirit will speak for itself. Woo. Oh, yeah, I done said something wrong. Did I say something wrong up in here? See, the spirit speaks for itself. And there's some things that we don't have a monopoly on. Amen. That's why when the spirit really begins to move, and in some churches they want to sit you down. Some places they want you to shut up. But I can see when you really got the spirit, you can't help but make a joyful noise unto the Lord. God, and I'm so glad I got it, because I didn't believe it, Bishop Wilson. I'm telling you now, some of y'all look at me funny, and people watch me on TV, and they think they see me praying for the sick and speaking in tongues and carrying on. See, I didn't know nothing about this until I was got about 15, 16 years old. But I'm telling you, when I prayed, what my grandmother told me, and this is no lie, she told me, and I didn't understand it, Bishop. I was upset because somebody came, and some friends of mine came to me and told me, they say, you need the Holy Ghost. Now, this, and maybe everybody don't believe this, but they came to me. They say, well, we know you're going to church, and you're singing in the choir. I was 15, 16 years old, but they said, you need the Holy Ghost. Y'all quiet now. That's what they told me, Bishop. They told, and I got upset because they was bad as all the Dickens. And I grew up in the church. I grew up in the denominational church. And when they told me that, I went to my good old mother who played the organ, played the piano. And I said, Mom, they telling me that I need the Holy Ghost. And I feel like I got everything I need as a kid. And she told me, she said, I tell you what you do, Robbie, just go and pray about it. She didn't know what she was saying. And I remember getting by the bed and praying. I said, Lord, if the Holy Ghost is real, I may can't get it in the church I'm going to, but they say I need the Holy Ghost. And I'm telling you, I went to sleep when the preacher was preaching, not in my church, another church. And I woke up in time for the altar call. And I say, God, if this is real, I want it now. And I walked to the altar. You talked about preserving our godly identity. And they told me, just lift your hands and ask God to forgive you of all your sins. And I'm not lying to you. At 15, 16 years old, the Holy Ghost fell on me. And I began to speak in tongues as the Spirit of God. Oh, y'all quiet up in here. See, some people say, well, they don't tell. I'm telling you, because I didn't know nothing about it. And Bishop, you know, in the church I came out of, you didn't do a lot of shouting. But when the Holy Ghost hit me and I started speaking in tongues, I didn't know what I was saying. And all of a sudden, Bishop Henderson, I started shouting. As a 15, 16 year old. Amen, somebody. But many years later, that same old mother that didn't believe in the Holy Ghost. Amen, somebody. Holy Ghost fell on her and she stole. Oh, y'all quiet up in here. That's why I tell you, anytime you come to church, you should come with a praise and say, Lord, have your way. Don't let nobody tell you it's not real, because it is real and it's just like fire. Ooh, my God. Let me read the scripture, because I can see some of y'all you say, amen. We didn't bring you to talk about the Holy Ghost. You're going to offend some folks. You're going to upset some folks. Like you was teaching today, Bishop, you upset folks when you get talking about the Holy Ghost. Amen. Holy Ghost. But what makes us identify with sanctification and holiness is the Holy Ghost. And if we ever lose, and I must say this, if we ever lose the intensity, if we ever lose the vigor and the conviction of embracing the Spirit of God, oh, Lord have mercy, then we're in trouble. I don't care who like it or who don't like it. Amen. If we ever try to identify with other folks that just don't believe in all that, and teaching on the radio and TV, it don't take all of that. And we say, well, maybe they got a point. They don't have nothing. How can somebody tell me what's right if they don't have it? Oh, y'all quiet up in here. Amen. The professor, the instructors. I heard you talking about academia, and that's a new movement in the college realm, academia, that says there's more than one way to God. There's more than one way to heaven. And sometimes you have to challenge even the erroneous teaching. Oh, Lord, I better. Amen. Don't y'all think for 1 minute there ain't no false prophets and false teachers. Jesus said it would be days like this. And if it ever was a time for the church to make a stand, it's now. Can I get, but you see, what God will do for us, he will anoint everything we say if it's according to the word. Oh, I feel an anointing in this place right now. And I believe that God is getting ready to anoint the church like never before. You don't have to compromise with the enemy to get folks saved. Folks are looking for truth. They're not looking for a manufactured gospel. They're looking for the word of God, because the only thing that will deliver folks from sin is the word of God. Come on and shout glory, somebody. Oh, I feel like preaching. Go with me to the book of Isaiah, chapter number 55. Oh, I shouldn't have said all of that. I should have just... Isaiah, chapter number 55 and verse number 8. Chapter number 55. We thank God for this very fine host of bishops on the roster. Let's give them a hand. Amen. All these bishops, Bishop Henderson, my friend. Come on, let's give these bishops a hand. Bishop Bobby Henderson and Bishop Asbury and Bishop Nesbitt, amen. And of course, Bishop Wilson and the dynamic, your dynamic leader, my friend, spiritual, amen, mentor. Let's give him a hand, Bishop Chandler Owens. Oh, come on, let's give it up for the bishop. Hallelujah. Amen. I don't believe in flattery, but I believe you need to give honor where honor is due. And Bishop Owen is a prince of preachers. Oh, yes, he is. Whether folks like it or not. Amen. I told him, he remember my cousin, Rabbi from Atlantic City, and I met him years ago when I was in press and crossed denominational lines. Bishop is noted as a man, an orator. And I'm telling you, you are blessed to have a man of this caliber. You may not realize it, but you are blessed to have a man of this caliber. I'm going to say it again. You are blessed to have a man of this caliber. Not a hireling, not somebody that is selfish and insecure, but one that loves the people of God. Bishop told me last night, I said, Bishop, what time you want me to get through? He said, don't worry about all of that. Just let the Lord use you. And some of y'all don't like that. I appreciate a man like that. I have good sense. I ain't crazy. I know some of y'all can't take too much preaching. I know y'all. Amen. Some of y'all come late, want to leave early. But anyway. But I'm telling you, he's an awesome. And I thank God. Now, I'm going to tell you, I'm already preaching if some of you don't know it. Bishop Asbury and Bishop Nesbitt. Now, some of you didn't make it today at 6:30, and I was here. And I plan on being here. I plan on changing my plans of leaving and being here, because I want to hear what these two bishops have to say. And it's rich. And preachers, young preachers, old preachers, you never can get enough information. Even if you don't agree with everything, iron sharpens iron. Amen. Amen, somebody. And many times we take things out of context and we create our own words, but I'm an advocate of the word. I love to be around people, amen, that are studious and have investigated different ideologies and different philosophies and theories. And sometimes it's just revelation. God reveals as you listen, as you hear. The book of Isaiah, chapter number 55 and verse number 8. And verse number 7, verse number 6, it talks about seeking the Lord while he may be found. But then the writer goes a little further, and he began to talk about, in verse number 7, let the wicked forsake his ways, and the unrighteous man his thoughts. And let him return unto the Lord, and he will have mercy upon him and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. But notice in verse number 8, it tells us, for our thoughts, my thoughts are not your thoughts, Neither are your ways my ways, saith the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. He says, for as the rain cometh down, and the snow from heaven, and returneth not thither, but watereth the earth, and maketh it bring forth and bud, that it may give seed to the sower and bread to the eater. So shall my word that goeth forth out of my mouth, it shall not return unto me void, but it shall accomplish that which I please, and it shall prosper in the thing whereto I sent it. Also, the book of Jeremiah, chapter number 29 and verse number 8, we are dealing with the children of God and the application can be directed to us, even though God gave multiple things to his called out one, his people that he had chosen for a divine purpose. There are three things that God has chosen us for: his purpose, his plan, and his promises. Purpose, plan, and promise. Romans 8:28 tells us, and we know that all things work together for the good to them that what? To them who are the call according to his purpose. And Jeremiah understood that. We thank God for Pastor. Amen. I see my good friend Pastor Evans is here from Hoganville. Amen. Thank God for him. The Bible says in chapter number 29, and God here is using Jeremiah to send a letter to the captives. See, some of us don't really understand the sovereignty of God, the way God works. His ways are not our ways. His thoughts are not our thoughts, because many of us think we're just saved by coincidence. Amen. And it can be very controversial when you talk about salvation, because I heard Bishop talking about Calvinism, super Calvinism, and et cetera. We won't get into that rhetoric because you got so many different views when it comes to salvation. But I'm convinced salvation is a process. Uh-oh. And if any of us understand that in clarity, Bishop Henderson, we will be more intensified with our walk with God. We will understand that God has chosen us. In spite of God choosing us, we have the power of choice. It's like a paradox. Amen, somebody. But when we look in chapter number 29, we can see that Jeremiah is sending a letter to encourage the believer, because it was a prophetic word in the book of Genesis to Abram: know of a surety that thy seed shall be taken into bondage. They shall afflict them how many years? 400 years. And that was a prophecy. That was a prophetic word that God had told Abram. He said, know of a surety, know of a certainty. It's just because I'm making you a father of all nations, I've got a plan. Amen. If I want to preach from this particular thought. I'm going to give you my subject because I feel something getting rolling here. God has not changed his mind. Grab somebody by the hand and tell them, God has not changed his mind. This letter that Jeremiah is writing, because you must understand in chapter number 1, God had to bring Jeremiah into clear understanding who he was. He told him, before you came out of the womb, before you came out of the belly, I knew you. And some of you know that chapter. And Jeremiah, after God started talking to him, Jeremiah put his two bits in. He said, but God, I'm nothing but a child. And God reprimanded him. He said, don't say that you're a child. Amen. In other words, I have called you for so much more. So Jeremiah is writing this letter, and he recognized the condition. He recognized the promises of God, but he also recognized there's two sides. There's another dimension. There's another area of promise, because many preachers, and many of us, we preach promises from a good perspective in our intellectual thinking, but we don't look at the promises of God that sometimes it causes us to go through the storm. Amen, somebody. We get excited. We get excited when the preacher talks about God promised you he's going to bring you out. He promised you he's going to bless you. He promised you he's going to do this and that and the other. But when is the last time you look at what God said, them that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer. Oh, my God. Persecution. They shall suffer persecution. See, amen. Didn't James pick it up? He said, my brethren, count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptations, knowing this, that the trying of your faith, the testing of your faith, work it patient. Let patient have her perfect work, that you may be perfect in time, wanting nothing. In other words, some of you don't realize it, but God is developing you. Everybody can shout when things are going good, but how many of y'all can shout when all hell done broke loose? When you can't see your way, when you don't know how you're going to come out of